Housekeeping. You're very, very welcome to our carol service. And the keen-eyed among you will notice that there are some candles lighting. So we want you to please just keep them in mind as you're standing up and sitting down if you're near them. And if something happens and a fire starts and somebody shouts the word fire. Those of you who are nearest the front can go out through these two doors, out the vestry door and out into the far corner of the car park, or around out the main gate towards an Iron Bedroom Court. Those of you nearer those doors you came in can go out through those doors, and there's a meeting point across the road at the entrance to an Iron Bedroom Court, but we trust that that will not be needed. We are also going live on Facebook. Now the camera will only be pointing this way, so you won't be seen, but you might be heard. So do sing up and don't share the three numbers on the back of your card with anyone, because it might be picked up on the microphone. It's a very sensitive microphone. So sing as much as you can. And we are praying that God will use our Facebook Live to reach more and more people. So that's it. Just be careful of the lit candles. At the end of the service, please stay where you are, and stewards will blow the candles out, and then you can make your way to the hall for your tea, coffee and mince pie. So please do stay where you are at the end. Let us blow the candles out before we start moving about. Thank you.
Well, good afternoon, everyone. And very warm welcome to you. Anne-Marie's already welcomed you. I'm also welcoming you this afternoon to our Carols by Candlelight service. Wonderful that we're able to be together this afternoon to sing these lovely carols and celebrate the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. I have just one or two other things I want to say. During our service this afternoon, we will be taking up an offering. Don't worry, if you haven't come prepared to give, that's fine. But if you'd like to, we're going to be taking up an offering this afternoon, which will be split between the food bank, our local food bank, and Christians Against Poverty. As we said, there'll be tea, coffee and mince pies afterwards. Please do stay. And we will go through without introducing things. So please stand and sing every time there is a carol. As we said, we'd love to hear you joining in. Well, this is the third Sunday of Advent, so we're going to light our third Advent candle. And the theme this afternoon is that of joy. Have I got that up there? Yes. And the scripture reading is from Luke chapter 1, verses 46 to 49. And Mary said, "My soul glorifies the Lord, and my spirit rejoices in God my Saviour, for he has been mindful of the humble state of his servant. From now on, all generations will call me blessed, for the Mighty One has done great things for me. Holy is his name." Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we thank you that this afternoon we're able to be together in this place to sing of the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. We pray that we will know this afternoon that you are here with us to lead us and guide us in everything that we do. And we pray that each one of us here will this afternoon, by your Holy Spirit, meet with the Lord Jesus Christ, in whose name we pray. Amen. Thank you.
angel Gabriel announces the birth of Jesus to Mary. The second reading is from Luke chapter 1, verses 26 to 38. In the sixth month of Elizabeth's pregnancy, God sent the angel Gabriel to Nazareth, a town in Galilee, to a virgin pledged to be married to a man named Joseph, a descendant of David. The virgin's name was Mary. The angel went to her and said, "Greetings, you who are highly favoured. The Lord is with you." Mary was greatly troubled at his words and wondered what kind of greeting this might be. But the angel said to her, "Do not be afraid, Mary. You have found favour with God. You will conceive and give birth to a son, and you are to call him Jesus. He will be great and will be called the Son of the Most High. The Lord God will give him the throne of his father David, and he will reign over Jacob's descendants forever. His kingdom will never end." "How will this be?" Mary asked the angel, "since I am a virgin." The angel answered, "The Holy Spirit will come on you, and the power of the Most High will overshadow you. So the Holy One to be born will be called the Son of God. Even Elizabeth, your relative, is going to have a child in her old age, and she who was said to be unable to conceive is in her sixth month, for no word from God will ever fail." "I am the Lord's servant," Mary answered. "May your word to me be fulfilled." And then the angel left her.
Thank you.
reading is about an angel announcing to Joseph the birth of Jesus. It's taken from Matthew's first chapter, verses 18 to 25. This is how the birth of Jesus the Messiah came about. His mother Mary was pledged to be married to Joseph, but before they came together, she was found to be pregnant through the Holy Spirit. Because Joseph, her husband, was faithful to the law and yet did not want to expose her to public disgrace, he had in mind to divorce her quietly. But after he had considered this, an angel of the Lord appeared to him in a dream and said, "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son, and you are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." All this took place to fulfill what the Lord had said through the prophet: "The virgin will conceive and give birth to a son, and they will call him Emmanuel, which means God with us." When Joseph woke up, he did what the angel of the Lord had commanded him and took Mary home as his wife. But he did not consummate their marriage until she gave birth to a son, and he gave him the name Jesus.
Well, we're living in a world at the moment, aren't we, where we may be inclined to think that it's vain for joy. We think of all the terrible things that are going on. Wars between Palestine and Israel, in the Ukraine, many other parts of the world too. If you think of poverty, even in our own country. Yes, there's a lot of things going on that concern us. And we're coming up to this time of Christmas, aren't we? It may seem that it's very little in the way of joy. But if we go right back to that first Christmas, we find that joy was brought to many people. And we've already read about two of them, Mary and Joseph. They were a couple who were going to be married. Mary was very young, probably about 14 or 15 years old. Joseph was probably much older, but we have read about what happened to them before they actually married. Both of them had a visit from an angel. Now, angels, let's be clear about this, were not fluffy creatures floating around on clouds. They'd be quite scary. And that is why to both of them, the angel said, "Do not be afraid." The angel came with a special message for both of them, and a promise was made from the angel that a special baby was to be born, the Saviour. We read what the angel said to Mary: "You will conceive and give birth to a son. You are to call him Jesus. He will be great and be called the Son of the Most High." And to Joseph: "Joseph, son of David, do not be afraid to take Mary home as your wife, because what is conceived in her is from the Holy Spirit. She will give birth to a son. You are to give him the name Jesus, because he will save his people from their sins." The Son of God sent down from heaven, he was to be the Saviour of the world, the one who had come to rescue people from the power of sin. So what was the response of Mary and Joseph to the message they received? Well, they believed it. They trusted God for it. Yes, when they heard the news at first, they were scared. But when they realized what it meant, it brought them great joy. Now, they needed to trust God. Mary was already expecting her baby, even though Joseph and Mary had not yet been together. And so how was this special child to be born? It was to be supernatural by the Holy Spirit, as we read a moment ago. Wow, you may say, that could never happen, could it? And yet Mary and Joseph believed it. They didn't say, no way that could happen. They trusted God, and that brought them great joy. What greater joy than to give birth to the one who was to be the saviour of the world. Thank you, Lord, for every good thing that you give to us. We thank you that we can give some of it back to you this afternoon. And as we do so, we pray particularly for the work of our local food banks and for Christians Against Poverty, that you would use those organisations for your glory to be a big help to people in this valley and to share something of the love of the Lord Jesus Christ with them. Because we ask it in his name. Amen. Amen.
Our fourth reading is from Luke 1, verses 1 to 7. In those days, Caesar Augustus issued a decree that a census should be taken of the entire Roman world. This was the first census that took place while Quirinius was governor of Syria. And everyone went to their own town to register. So Joseph also went up from the town of Nazareth in Galilee to Judea, to Bethlehem, the town of David, because he belonged to the house and line of David. He went there to register with Mary, who was pledged to be married to him and was expecting a child. While they were there, the time came for the baby to be born, and she gave birth to her firstborn, a son. She wrapped him in clothes and placed him in the manger, because there was no guest room available for them.
Christmas. We repeatedly check our lists. Have I ordered the food, bought all the presents, invited people, decorated the house, and sent the Christmas cards? We can get so wrapped up in the busyness and what the shops have to sell us that we can miss the most important thing, what God has to give us. From almost the beginning of time, God was getting the world ready for the first Christmas. Shepherds on the hills near Bethlehem were made ready for Christmas as angels told them about the Saviour who is Christ the Lord. The wise men were ready for Christmas as they followed the star which led them to Jesus. The Son of God was coming to earth to save us from ourselves, our sin, and Satan. The baby who was laid in a wooden crib would eventually be laid on a wooden cross. He took on himself the sin of the world. God's love is such that Jesus came to pay the price for our wrong. He died that we might be forgiven and brought to know God. Asking Jesus to become your Lord and Saviour is the best way to be ready for Christmas and the new year and all the future. You never really know the joy of Christmas until you look to God and tell him that you have received his gift to you.
Our fifth reading is about the shepherds hearing of the birth of Jesus. The reading is from Luke chapter 2, verses 8 to 20. And there were shepherds living out in the fields nearby, keeping watch over their flocks at night. An angel of the Lord appeared to them, and the glory of the Lord shone around them. And they were terrified. But the angel said to them, "Do not be afraid. I bring good news that will cause great joy for all people. Today, in the town of David, a Savior has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. This will be a sign to you. You will find a baby wrapped in cloths and lying in a manger." Suddenly, a great company of the heavenly host appeared with the angel, praising God and saying, "Glory to God in the highest heaven, and on earth peace to those on whom his favor rests." When the angels had left them and gone into heaven, the shepherds said to one another, "Let's go to Bethlehem and see this thing that has happened, which the Lord has told us about." So they hurried off and found Mary and Joseph and the baby who was lying in the manger. When they had seen him, they spread the word concerning what had been told them about this child, and all who heard it were amazed at what the shepherds said to them. But Mary treasured up all these things and pondered them in her heart. The shepherds returned, glorifying and praising God for all the things they had heard and seen, which were just as they had been told.
So there were these shepherds out on the night shift. Shepherds in those days were really hardy types. They'd be out in all sorts of weather with the sheep to look after them, to make sure no harm came to them. And so they were used to all sorts of things. They had to protect the sheep from being attacked by other animals and to stop other people coming and stealing them. So these shepherds could look after themselves. They wouldn't easily be afraid. But one night, something very frightening did happen. They saw an angel. Now remember, angels are not fluffy things on clouds, but scary enough to even frighten those hardened shepherds. Just like with Mary and Joseph, the angel had a message for the shepherds. And as he gave the message, we are told that the glory of God was shining like a bright light. Now the hillside would have been dark, there may have been a few stars in the sky, but this light was certainly bright. I don't know whether you've ever walked around a dark building and suddenly a security light comes on. And doesn't that seem really bright because it's so dark? Well, this glory, this light was even brighter than that. And these shepherds, it's fair to say, were terrified. Not only did they see this angel, but they had this bright light to contend with. And then just like with Mary and Joseph, the angel told them not to be afraid. He had a message which would bring great joy to them and to everyone else too. It was actually the same message that had been given to Mary and Joseph. Today in the town of David, a Saviour has been born to you. He is the Messiah, the Lord. And so the Saviour being born was to bring joy to them. And then a mighty choir of angels sang, "Glory to God in the highest, and on earth peace to those on whom his favour rests." So, after they've heard all this, what did the shepherds decide to do? They decided to run off and find this child. They didn't think, that's interesting, and carry on looking after the sheep. No, they had to go and see this baby who had been born, because they knew that this message was true. This message had come from the Lord, and they went to find him. They knew that this Saviour was born for them, and that brought them great joy.
Other here, Father, that across the world there is so much conflict and unrest going on. So we want to thank you for the peace that we enjoy, for the freedoms that we enjoy, and we want to pray for those who are in the midst of conflict in the Middle East, in Ukraine and Russia, and in many other places in the world. And Father, we pray, Father, as people who love you and follow you and serve you are working in various different aid agencies to bring relief to some of the hunger and the cold and the suffering that's going on, Father, we pray you would provide and you would bless and you keep them in our prayers, Lord God, that we would be thankful for all we have and that we would bring those who are in great need to you. But Father, we thank you that your word tells us that you are Lord of all, that Jesus is Lord of all, and all means all. All means everything, on a global scale, on a local scale, on a personal scale, all means all. So as well as the worldwide problems, we think, Father, of problems that are more local to us here, in this country, in this town, in this valley, issues of poverty, issues of family distress, issues of addiction, issues, Father, of mental and physical and spiritual health that is just not working the way it should. Father God, we pray for our health system, we pray for our local council, we pray for our local government, and we ask, Father God, that you would use all of these many bodies that have been put together to bring relief and provision for those who are in need. But Father, you've called us as Christians, you've called us to reach out with this wonderful gospel of hope and truth, to bring it out to others, to bring it to the people around us, to show love, even just by how we interact with one another. So we pray, even in these last few days before Christmas, you give us opportunities to bring the light of the world with us wherever we go. Because your word tells us that the light shone in the darkness. The darkness did not understand it, but it did not stop it from shining. So, Father, let us take the light with us wherever we go, even in our pain, even in our struggling, even in our need. Let us take it with us, broken as we are, imperfect as we are. Let us take it with us that we might show some of your glory and some of your wonder to those that we encounter day by day. We want to thank you for sending Jesus, Father. Thank you, Jesus, for being willing to come. And we pray, Father, that you will continue to bless us so that we can bless others, and that you, Lord, will be glorified in all that we do during this Christmas season. We pray in that mighty, wonderful name of our beautiful Saviour, Jesus. Amen.
Amen.
Let's say the Lord's Prayer together. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us this day our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. And lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen.
Our sixth reading is from John chapter 1, reading verses 1 to 14. Jesus, the Word, came into the world as a human being. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was with God in the beginning. Through him all things were made. Without him nothing was made that has been made. In him was life, and that life was the light of all mankind. The light shines in the darkness, and the darkness has not overcome it. There was a man sent from God whose name was John. He came as a witness to testify concerning that light, so that through him all might believe. He himself was not the light. He came only as a witness to the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. He was in the world, And though the world was made through him, the world did not recognize him. He came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Yet to all who did receive him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become children of God. Children born not of natural descent, nor of human decision or husband's will, but born of God. The Word became flesh and made his dwelling among us. We have seen his glory, the glory of the one and only Son, who came from the Father, full of grace and truth.
It was not a silent night. There was blood on the ground. You could hear a woman cry in the alleyway that night on the streets of David's town. And the stable was not clean, and the cobblestones were cold, and little Mary, full of grace, with the tears upon her face, had no mother's hand to hold. It was a labor of pain. It was a cold sky above. Before the girl on the ground in the dark, every beat of her beautiful heart, it was a labor of love. Noble Joseph by her side, calloused hands and weary eyes. There were no midwives to be found on the streets of David's town in the middle of the night. So he held her and he prayed, shafts of moonlight on his face. But the baby in her womb, he was the maker of the moon. He was the author of the faith that could make the mountains move. It was a labor. Was it?
I trust we've seen this afternoon that the coming of the Saviour brought joy to people. He brought joy to Mary and Joseph. He brought joy to the shepherds, and indeed joy to many others at that time. And he can bring joy to us here today. Those verses you read a few moments ago from John's Gospel tell us of the Word of God, his Son, coming into the world. He is called the light. The true light that gives light to everyone was coming into the world. And we're not just talking here about the bright light that the shepherds saw, although that was dramatic enough. Jesus came into the world to bring light by the things that he did and the things that he said. And that had an impact upon the people at the time. But the thing is this, not all of them believed, because we read, he came to that which was his own, but his own did not receive him. Even though he came as light from God, not everyone was like the shepherds. Some did not believe, but many others did. Because we read, to all who received him, to those who believed in his name, he gave the right to become the children of God. And it was not just for those at that time, but it's for people like you and people like me. The Saviour was born for you and me. I want to say to you this afternoon that you can receive him this afternoon by faith and become one of his children. And then you can know something of the joy of Mary and Joseph and the shepherds. But you may be saying, why should I receive him? Well, we've already seen, he came into the world a saviour. Each and every one of us here this afternoon needs a saviour. Now, you may not think that, but it's true, because all of us here this afternoon have done things that are wrong. All of us have done things that need forgiveness. And forgiveness comes through this Saviour who was born and brought such joy to those you've seen. And he can bring joy into your life too this afternoon. Well, how did he do that? How did he provide forgiveness? Well, we're celebrating his birth this afternoon and the joy that that brings. But we need to go to the end of his life, because he was put to death on a cross. Even though he was God come in human form, even though he never did anything that was wrong, he was put to death on a cross. And then as he died, he took upon himself the punishment for all the wrong things that we have done. And now we can be forgiven. And that is the good news of Christmas. And that can bring you great joy as well. And that brings great joy into this world too. This world that seems so short of joy. So can I ask you, will you come to him this afternoon? Will you say to him, thank you for your birth into this world. Thank you for your death, which means I can be forgiven. I want to put my trust in you. And if you do that, you will know his forgiveness in your life. Not only in this world, but when life ends, you will go to be with him forever. And there will be more joy than you can ever imagine. Put your trust in Jesus. You will have great joy. Thank you. Well, can I thank you all for being here this afternoon. It's lovely to see you all. And thank you for singing so well. It's been lovely to sing these carols together, hasn't it? Just a reminder, as you can see, that we're going to have tea, coffee and mince pies in the hall in a few moments after the candles have been blown out. So please remember that. But you're very welcome to stay with us. Have a cup of tea or coffee and a mince pie in the hall. And on the tables in the hall, you'll find some leaflets which will explain a little bit more about the Christian faith. If you'd like to take one of those, please do so. Maybe take one for somebody else as well. Like just explaining a little bit more about what we've been talking about this afternoon, about the Lord Jesus Christ and his coming into this world. So, a prayer to finish. May you be filled with the wonder of Mary, the obedience of Joseph, the joy of the angels, the eagerness of the shepherds, and the determination of the Magi, and the peace of the Christ child. Almighty God, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, bless you now and forever. Amen.